from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you with thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
we say and do, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Psalm today is Psalm 16. 220 and 221 in the front of your hymnal. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, you are my God, my Lord, my good above all other.
Almighty God, is upon the godly that are in the land, upon those who are noble among the people.
But those who run after other gods shall have their troubles multiplied.
Their migrations will be upon my wall. You will take the names of their gods upon my lips.
O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot.
My boundaries and borders of pleasant land. Indeed, I have no heritage.
I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night.
I have set the Lord always before me. Because it is the hour of my hand, I shall not fall.
My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope.
For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the dead.
You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The second lesson is from 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. For Paul, Christian spirituality entails living in the reality of the Holy Spirit. The driving force behind our actions and values is not our sinful desire for self-satisfaction, but the very spirit by which God raised Jesus from the dead and will also raise us from the dead. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies, also through his Spirit that dwells in you. This epistle was written to encourage Christians experiencing hardships and suffering because of their faith in Christ. The letter opens by blessing God for the living hope we have through Christ's resurrection, even amid difficult circumstances and surroundings. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Here ends the reading. Then the disciples disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. When Jesus did show up later and showed him his wounds, you know where they nailed him to the cross? His hands, his side, where they put the sword in. Yeah, he showed him all that. But the neat thing is that Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet still believe." So he's talking to us, isn't he? He said, "How wonderful that you believe. You haven't seen me yet, but you believe. I do too." We haven't physically seen Jesus, but we can still believe in him because of the Bible. That's right. We might hear about Jesus from other people, and that's great, but we have the Word of God. That's the most important thing. We have the stories of the Bible. We know that God's word is always true. In order to trust someone or something, we have to know that they are trustworthy. We have to be able to believe what they say. Well, we don't have to worry about that with the Bible, do we? No, because it is absolutely true and trustworthy. The Bible gives us great hope. We can't see God in person.
person right here, right now. We can't actually see him like you and I are looking at each other. But he's here. We see evidence and we know he gives us life. The Bible is God's word, given to us so that we can know and we can believe. Let's fold our hands and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for giving us the Bible.
We thank you so much for giving us the Bible.
That we may read about you. And your love for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
The sermon today is concluded by Pastor Dan Corbett. Grace, mercy, and peace be yours from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Alleluia. Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen indeed. Alleluia. It is good to gather today as we continue our celebration of Easter. For me, this reading from John's Gospel has always been one of my favorites, because I can absolutely relate to Thomas and the disciples in ways that I probably cannot from last week's reading. Last week we had Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, who faithfully headed to the tomb early in the morning, believing that a miracle would happen. I'd like to believe that I would have the faith that the two Marys would show up that morning, but when I'm really honest with myself, I don't know if I would. Then there's the angel who rolls the stone away and tells the Marys not to be afraid. For those who know me, you know that I'm not the angel type, so I can't relate to that character either. And then there's Jesus. Nope, not me. But this week's story, I can totally relate to just about everyone in the story. And maybe you can too. We have the disciples who are locked in the place where they are staying out of fear. Fear that what happened to Jesus might happen to them too. Fear that they are not certain of what will come next for them after their lives have been upended. A general fear of the future. Are you ever afraid of the future? I know I am. And even after Jesus greets them, says, "Peace be with you," and breathes the Holy Spirit upon them, they still are locked in this place a week later. Again, I don't know about you, but I think that I can relate to that sense of fear. Even knowing that Jesus is with me, even knowing that Jesus has given the church everything we need to live as the resurrected people of God, even with all that, we still sometimes just want to lock ourselves in our homes, in our churches, because it just feels safer. And then there's Thomas. I always wonder what it was that Thomas was doing while the rest of his friends were hiding away. In my faithful imagination, he was actually the disciple who maybe believed that there was something good to come, and he wanted to go and see what God was up to. But wherever he is, he misses the encounter with the resurrected body of Jesus. And so when he comes back, he doesn't believe the others. He needs proof for himself. Are there times that you struggle to believe? Are there times when the weight of the world, when the struggles of this life, when the complexities all around you make it difficult to believe that the story of resurrection might be true? Do you maybe yearn for more proof? A hidden camera, perhaps, from 2,000 years ago that shows what the faithful woman first saw? Maybe you don't, but I do. I can absolutely relate to Thomas. I want so badly to have an unwavering, unshakable, unfaltering belief in Jesus, but sometimes I struggle too. So between the disciples and Thomas, I find these characters this week far more relatable than the ones from last week, which makes the way that Jesus interacts with them all the more powerful. Jesus doesn't come to the disciples in the locker room and say, "You dummies, why are you locked in here? Why can't you just believe and live the lives I told you to live?" No. He sees them. He looks at them, at us, with compassion and love, and says, "Peace be with you." In the midst of our fear, in the midst of their uncertainty, in the midst of everything, Jesus comes not with judgment, but with peace and grace and love and understanding. And then he gives us a gift. The gift of the Holy Spirit as we strive to go and tell the good news. possibly see. I love you. Those are the words that Jesus speaks to us in the midst of our uncertainty. Not judgment, but love. Not condemnation, but hope. Not tearing down, but building up. Friends, life is complicated, and there are lots of voices out there that are happy to condemn you, that are eager to tell you that you have no worth. They cannot wait to make you feel terrible. Those voices speak lies. But we worship the one who speaks truth. We worship the resurrection and the life. We worship the giver of peace. We worship the one who breathes the Spirit upon us. We worship the one who speaks to us in our doubts, fears, and failures. The one who was willing to come into the locked rooms of our hearts, minds, beliefs, and congregations, and speak transformation. We worship Jesus. He loves you and me and all. We worship Jesus, who honors the faithfulness of Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, who gathers with the disciples in the locked room, and who is willing to offer to Thomas grace upon grace. This Easter season, may you embrace the love that Jesus showers upon you, and may you have the courage to share it with others. May you turn out the voices that tell you that you are not good enough, that you don't believe enough, that your doubts and fears are wrong, and instead may you cling to the resurrected one. Trust in the love of God overcomes everything. Jesus is with us. Alleluia. Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Thank you.
your resurrection brings refreshment to a weary world. Following the women at the tomb, empower us to boldly share your radical love through our words and our work. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
As you breathe your spirit into the disciples, breathe your spirit of healing upon all creation. Nourish the earth with sufficient rains. Strengthen us to counter the effects of pollution and destruction. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You prepared the disciples for their ministry by calming their fears and granting them your peace. Equip our community's leaders. Give them a spirit of peace and hearts that burn for justice, that their leadership reflects your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You come among us in unexpected ways. Send us to those who hide in fear or question your love. Be a healing presence for any isolated by addiction, incarceration, mental illness, chronic pain, sickness, or grief. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
As you met the disciples on the road to Emmaus, show us your presence along our journeys. Bless our doubts and questions. Provide trusting and safe relationships for all ages to nurture our connection to you and one another. Hear us, O God. Resurrecting God, you bring us to new life every day. Thank you for blessing us with companions on our journey, especially those who now rest in your love. Strengthen us with the eternal peace of your promises. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Hear us now as we pray the words that Christ has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.